On behalf of the Women's Leadership and Resource Center and the Gender and Women's Studies Program at the University of Illinois Chicago, welcome to our Feminism's Lunch Lecture today, Travails of Traveling. How does gender influence public transport choices? We're so happy to have you with us. A little bit about our program. So WLRC's Feminism's Lunch Lecture Series offers faculty and staff, students, visiting scholars, and activists an opportunity to present their projects, ideas, and works in progress on a wide range of topics and engage participants in lively and provocative discussion. This year, we've been partnering with the Gender and Women's Studies Department to feature UIC students and others whose current research, creative, or community projects engage feminist movements and scholarship. Our presenter today is UIC anthropology PhD student, Nirupama Jayaraman. Nirupama Jayaraman is an urban anthropologist with research interests spanning the interdisciplinary fields of sociocultural anthropology, cultural geography, science and technology studies, gender studies, and urban planning. As part of her dissertation research, she studies gendered mobility and access to public transportation infrastructure in the South Indian city of Madurai. She holds an MA in development studies from the Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, where her postgraduate thesis focused on understanding the politics of heritage and urbanization in Chennai, India. Nirupama also has prior experience working in the public policy and development consultancy sectors in India. She currently freelances as a translator and interpreter for OxoHub India. Friends, please welcome our presenter, Nirupama Jayaraman.
Hi, thank you so much for the space. I'm so excited to be here. Good afternoon, everybody, and I'm really happy to be able to share my work through this amazing platform that's been provided by WLRC and GWS here at UIC. I'm just gonna quickly share my screen. Yes, okay, so you should be able to see my slides now. Thank you for the confirmation, Ramona. Before I started, I wanted to thank Ramona and Prof. K for all the coordination back and forth to make sure that this event could happen. And I'm also really thankful to my advisor, Dr. Tarini Bedi, and Professor Sanjeev Vidyarthi for being here as my discussants. So I'm going to be presenting my work, which is in progress, where I look at gender and public transport in the South Indian city of Madurai. This is currently based on preliminary field work that I was able to conduct in December 2021. And my field work was possible due to the NSF REG grant that is provided by Dr. Bedi's NSF grant. This is one of my bus stops where I spent some time doing my field work. And as Ramona said, the title of my talk is Travails of Traveling, How Does Gender Influence Public Transport Choices? So I'd like to start by giving a little introduction to how I'm structuring my talk today. I'll introduce my project and identify the theoretical context in which I seek to locate my work. Next, I'll talk a little bit about the city of Madurai and establish the geographical significance. And after this, I'll talk a little bit about the tools and methods that I used during my fieldwork. And this will be followed by certain observations from my preliminary field research. And finally, I'll end by talking about my future plans for the project. This is the part where I talk about the project introduction. Please do bear with me for the academic jargon. This is going to be there mostly only in this slide, and I promise. So I'm really interested in understanding the urban. This is where most of my research, past and present, has been located in. And so James Heitzman talks about the support that is afforded to smaller cities and towns across South Asia. And in talking about what really is urban in this new or emerging global south is really important, especially when we move from the larger metropolis areas that we're usually used to. And so, which is the main reason for me situating my work in Madurai. Another part of my project, of course, focuses on how women across the world have access to transportation. And this is, it has been a struggle in many cases. And in fact, through whether it is through seats that are allocated specifically for women or having the specific infrastructure and bus stands and so on. So those are some of the ways in which I've been thinking, I got to thinking about my project. And of course, with respect to how I'm looking at access to public transport, I do situate a lot of my work within body literature and looking at anthropology of the body specifically. So I look at gendered mobility and the personal access to public transportation. One of the most integral infrastructure systems within the city is transportation, especially in South Asia. And so to understand how this sort of transport infrastructure influences and is influenced by the end user, which is the commuter, it is really important to explore the social space that is occupied by the commuter. And so I just wish to understand how gender influences choice and usage of public transport in Madurai. And I draw upon scholarship from anthropology, gender studies, urban planning, and human geography. Moving on, a little bit about Madurai. So this is this is a map of Madurai that has been generated through ArcGIS. So Madurai is often called a temple city, and it is also identified very often as the cultural capital of the state of India. And it was in fact an administrative capital and travel hub since the rule of the Pandya dynasty in 16th century circa, until the British occupation, following which it declined in economic significance due to its landlocked geography. In fact, even during the Mughal rule in India, the Mughals annexed Madurai was the last part of their national annexation. And it is often Madurai's fame to claim in a lot of national debates. Madurai was designed as a temple city. And here you can see these sort of concentric quadrilaterals. The innermost quadrilateral are the four streets around the temple. And I'm just going to set out the layout of Madurai for easier understanding as I talk through my project. And so if you ask a local Madurai person, they are very likely to say that Madurai for them is only these four streets around the temple. And as you can see, the city has sort of developed in concentric quadrilaterals right around this. And so it was designed, the city was designed according to ancient Vastu Sastra in India. And so the first in a concentric circles have to do with the temple. They come with the temple economy. And right outside there is a business hub, which likely was established around Mughal times. There are pre-colonial times, essentially. There are multiple evidences and arguments supporting that. And then comes the next circle, which was established during the colonial era with specifically for local governance and organization. And after independence, of course, is when the newly building national fervor resulted in a lot of these national organizations such as Indian Oil and many other government quarters that are seen as part of the old town of Madurai today. And these are the areas that are usually where government officials find their residence. And today, residential growth is seen across the city. And with post-liberalization in India, which is since the 1990s, there has been a lot of capital which has come into the country. And that sort of development can be seen in the outermost quadrilateral with a lot of malls and the new age symbols of what a city is supposed to look like. It is also, I guess, important for me to talk a little bit about the culture, the public culture in the city. Madurai is very, very well known for its temples and it is mostly identified as a Hindu city. And this is, of course, this comes with a lot of underlying religious and caste underpinnings. And the way in which people dress, or the very specific language, the type of Tamil, the local language is Tamil in the state of Tamil Nadu. And even the Tamil that they speak is supposed to be, has a different, is of a different dialect. That's a little bit about the cultural context. Moving on, these are some of the research questions. My main research question is, of course, how do women experience public transport in a small city? And I've sort of divided this, and this is sort of the theoretical purposes of the project. What impact does the spatial context of smaller cities have on public transport as a gendered experience? How does people's gender, whether perceived or self-identified, play a role in their usage of public transport? And finally, what are the external, and this usually refers to state actors, that influence, whether through gender-focused policies, you know, everyday transport decisions, and how? And so through these questions, I was able to, get onto the field in December. And two of the main methods that I used, I was in Madurai for about 2 weeks. And I conducted participant observation and interviews. So there are three main bus stands in the city of Madurai. And there's one in Mattathavani, and there's one called Periyar bus stand. These are the two places that I conducted my participant observation in. There is yet another bus stand called Arapalayam, which usually connects the city of Madurai to other villages. Therefore, it did not feel as relevant to my research. And so Periyar bus stand connects only the city of Madurai. It provides services only for the city of Madurai, whereas Mattathavani also connects other local villages. So this is the background in which I was able to speak to women. I spoke to a lot of the commuters, as well as vendors in these markets. Apart from this, I was also able to conduct interviews with very few state officials. Mostly it was about making contact and getting in touch with the local corporation officials. So those were the methods. And so moving on to the observations. This first part is in Tamil, and I've translated it into English for ease of access. So the first observation that came up with a lot of my conversations is that the access to transport in Madurai seems to be rather multimodal. So as you can see, this is one of my typical respondents. She was able to come to the bus stop she was able to walk to this particular bus stop, take another cab, go to another place, go to her work, and then take a share auto and then get back to her house using another bus from another bus stop, from another bus stand. So it's really interesting that just to traverse what is seen as a rather small city, auto drivers that I spoke to said that the city would not amount to more than 15 kilometers on each side. So for such a small city, when people are moving through it, they need to, especially the women, need to use multimodal transport just because that is what is convenient for them. And so they sort of switch between buses or cabs or share autos depending on convenience. And this is especially important because the use and prevalence of share autos, which is essentially the autos that are there in India, but they're just built a little, instead of the usual three-seater auto, it's just built a little bigger to accommodate. It's supposed to be 5, but usually they fit in about 10 people in a share auto. And the reason that these have become so popular is that share autos have specific routes, whether just like buses, but they're much shorter. And because a share auto goes from point A to point B, irrespective of how many commuters it has, the cost is much lesser than an auto, and it is much more convenient and frequent than buses. So a lot of people end up, and this is how Sharotos typically pick their fare, they choose a few bus stops and they just go by bus stops where people are waiting and pick them up. And whether or not other people get on the Sharoto, it's the same price. So people obviously prefer this a lot more. And when I spoke to certain female auto drivers in the city, they spoke about how there was a decrease in the usage of autos. And though the prevalence of sharing economy through Uber and the local Indian South Asian app really called Ola had started moving into Madurai, these were only driven, like only inexperienced drivers who were just beginning to drive an auto or cab in the city worked through these platforms, because that has been written on multiple sharing economy papers, but these platforms don't usually pay their drivers. And this was the reason that a lot of the auto drivers cited for not getting on these platforms. That was one observation. The other one is that it's very interesting to look at the access to mobility that is provided within the city. As I mentioned earlier, there are three bus stands across the city, and the buses typically go in the rectangle or in the quadrilateral that was pictured in the map earlier. And according to state transport officials, these buses, the city buses, travels about 45 kilometers on all sides of the city. And so when they say city bus, it goes beyond what everybody considers the city boundaries, including the corporation officials themselves. And this is where the governance part of it gets very interesting, because while all of the infrastructure is maintained by the local corporation, the actual bus service itself is run by a state-level organization. And this is also the importance of the state of Tamil Nadu also comes out in this particular quote, where and a lot of people said this, the fact that the current chief minister of Tamil Nadu, right after he came to power, approved free buses for women. And this was after 11 a.m. every day. And according to many women that I spoke to, this has increased, especially the women vendors who work in the bus stand. They were like, a lot of people have now started coming, and you can see that there are these women who are using the free bus service. So as more and more people are out now, and this doesn't matter whether or not COVID was existing, whether or not people wore masks. In fact, it was very rare that I saw anyone with a mask. I might have been the only person there with a mask. And that made me stand out more than anything, for as much as participant observation goes. So the access to mobility is defined, from my understanding of talking to interlocutors, is defined more along state levels than local levels. And they're not as invested in different routes, because they, as mentioned earlier, go depending on convenience. They choose different modes of travel depending on convenience. It is not, oh, I don't have a bus here, so I won't be able to go to this particular neighborhood. I found that this was interesting, especially because it's a smaller and planned city. Moving on, this is where I'd like to play a little audio clip. I'm going to see how the... Yes, okay, I'm able to share sound. You won't be able to really make anything out, but I'm just playing it just for that particular reason. Okay, so for those in the audience that understand Tamil, you would have probably found it pretty funny, because this was an announcement that kept playing in one of the bus stands that I was in. And this was an announcement by the local police. And this literally says, if there is someone suspicious asking questions, or offering you food or coming up to talk to you, don't engage with them. And this was happening right when I was going up to women and convincing them to talk to me. So that might, the local police might have scared away a few of my interlocutors. I think I'm going to blame them for that. But just this notion of be careful, be aware of your surroundings is all part of this commuting process. And as I say process, there is a certain skill involved. There are all these underlying contexts that we all take for granted every day when we commute. For example, within the bus stand, Matatavani, which is where I conducted most of my participant observation and interviews, because it's a place where local and city buses and the local town buses come in, there is a mini economy. In fact, the number of stops, there are about, I guess there are 10 platforms, out of which 4 are reserved for city buses, and these are right in front. And there's also auto stands within and right outside the bus stand. So you can see that as soon as people get off, they have end access to wherever the destination needs to be. However, that end access is not necessarily provided by the state. But because this particular bus stand also has people who come in and wait, since Madurai is also a hub of transportation for local villages, there's an entire mini market, entire mini economy within this bus stand. There are 80 flower vendors, 80 women, in fact, who have taken license to sell flowers, because that's how many commuters pass by, and they were all able to get business. But this was, of course, before COVID. There are a multitude of other food shops or random toys for kids. There is a separate life in itself in this one bus stand. Despite all of this, what was very telling to me, and this is of course reminiscent of much public work on gender and public space, women in public spaces, specifically Shilpa Phadke's work about how women were carefully occupying space. For example, when I was sitting down at a bench and I was writing or I was texting, just talking to somebody, if the seats next to me were empty, 9 out of 10, only a young woman would come sit next to me. And these were the kind of people that were willing to talk to me. So especially if they saw me talking to a stranger and then someone else came up. And so I didn't even have to move in a lot of cases, because people would keep coming. And this sort of transient nature of conversations also speaks to how women use and spend their time in waiting. And there is a lot of literature about, especially in human geography, about waiting and all of these parts of commute. But when we talk about specifically women occupying a certain public anxiety that we face when we go out in a public space in India, it makes it all the more, I guess, important to look at the ephemeral connections that then get formed when you just occupy space next to another woman you might not strike up a conversation with them, but you might just find it safer to sit next to another woman. And something else that was really, really noticeable was how many women were just on the phone. I walked into the bus stand and I could just hear so much noise. Of course, it's all the traffic, but there are just women talking on the phone constantly. There are at least five women on each platform. They're just sitting there and talking. So when I brought it up with a few of my interlocutors, they were like, this is the only time that I get to myself. I'm traveling, I'm not doing anything specifically. And this time, this is my leisure time. And this is also how I can be productive. I can catch up on stuff that, catch up with my friends or talk to people And yeah, there's just so much happening in these bus stands. There is, as I mentioned, and that's the buying and selling, especially because of the flower vendors, and Madurai is known for its jasmine flowers. There's obviously a lot of buying of those flowers. In both the bus stands, I saw a significant number of women selling, flower vendors selling flowers. And this is especially interesting because the second bus stand, the Periyar bus stand, had just opened. That week that I went there was when it had reopened after 6 years. For 6 years, the bus stand, the main bus stand in the city, had been just on the road. People would catch the buses on the road, and the buses would stop in the middle of the road at an at a signal, and that would be the stop. That would be the stand where people had to negotiate and find other platforms or other buses that they needed to connect to. And in all of this, really, what I was able to identify is that commuting is a skill because, and again, there is much literature in human geography about this, but especially in the case of Periyar bus stand, which had opened just a week before, all the regular commuters already knew where to go. There was this picture here, which I could make no sense of, not because it was in Tamil, but because I didn't know where I needed to catch a bus to go. These numbers don't make sense. They repeat. And there is a specific language right here that I couldn't get, but the regular commuters were able to understand. And they pointed me towards different places where I had to go to talk to different people. And in these habits of waiting and sitting or walking and talking, there was a lot of action, even during the time, you know, during wait, which is usually, you would probably consider a moment of stillness in the journey, but it really is not. It comes with its own set of actions. So that was my rambling set of observations. I tried to sort of compress them and present them as legibly as I could. Now, moving on to the next part of my presentation. So future field plans, of course, I hope to go back. This was just 2 weeks in Madurai, and I really want to go back and do a lot more work. Two other types of analysis that I would like to conduct are to look at archival plans for the city of Madurai and to understand more about how the city was set up. So far, what I've heard is through my interlocutors, that people who've lived in Madurai all their lives, or through government officials who have heard this, like they've just heard through their years of service in the corporation. But I do want to see the actual plans, and it's obviously been hard getting it, but once I go back, I'm hoping that I'll be able to get access for that. And another thing that I'd really like to look at is traffic data. This is, again, something that's been promised to me. Don't know how it'll work out, thanks to government organizations. But I'd like to conduct a spatial analysis to sort of see how buses move between these bus stands and what the traffic flows are sort of like. And if possible, map it with my own ethnographic data from women and female commuters, basically, who travel between these bus stops. And going back, when I go back, I'd like to talk to students of Lady Doe College, but this Lady Doe College is only because I've established connection with, established contact with them, and I've been given permission to talk to them and conduct surveys amongst the students of that college. And of course, I'd like to continue with my ethnography of female commuters and perhaps map out their daily lives, one of which I showed earlier, but something similar to that and something far more detailed. And finally, and this is always going to be the hardest, especially in a state like in a country like India, but to be able to sit down and talk to state bus transport officials about how they essentially run this, because obviously there is just in finding who I had to talk to or who would have data that I wanted, I ran from one neighborhood to another. I had to go between different offices, and it was three different auto rides. It took me like 5 hours in one day to trace just to get into the correct building to be able to talk to people. So to actually get permission and to sit down and talk with officials is going to be hard, but I believe that it will truly bring in the nuance that I'd really like to show in my work. So that's for future field plans. With respect to certain ideas that I've been playing with since my field work, there are two key ideas that came up with my culinary fieldwork, and I alluded to these in my presentation. The first idea is about how, because these women that I saw in the bus stands were constantly on their phone, and talking to them, they spoke about how there was safety involved, that they would call their family back home and tell them so that they wouldn't worry, or just, you know, if it was a weird place, weird as in like if they did not find themselves comfortable or had any kinds of concerns, they could call somebody and just talk to them. And so by ensuring this safety of female commuters, and with a little bit of reflexivity, I also figured that it was an inconspicuous device of note making for me, because instead of sitting and writing notes, where people would always come up and they would look over my shoulder and ask, oh, what are you writing? Even when I'm talking to them and making notes, they're like, are you writing? Is that something bad? Please don't write anything. And so instead of that, if I just switched to, say, WhatsApp, then it made my note taking all that more inconspicuous. And so that, toying with this idea, I'm trying to see, and in fact, in a conference presentation that I gave recently, I was talking about how the mobile phone furthers feminist mobility and ethnography because of how it ensures that it eases access to mobility. And so that was one idea that I've been working with. Another one, which again, I've been thinking through, is about how, and this is something that I was talking a lot about in the presentation, but how commuting could be a habit, and it has a certain memory, and especially for female commuters in public transport networks. There is a certain embodied memory of that is identified in daily transit. And, you know, this is through hypervigilance or dressing a certain way, or even, you know, occupying, walking a certain way, or just like keeping your arms to yourselves, you know, things like that. It indulges the anxieties of occupying public spaces, women. And so basically I argue that female commuters in public transport networks embody a specific memory of daily transit that is rooted both in the skills of commuting as well as the anxieties of occupying public spaces. So those were the two main ideas that I've been working through, and there's a lot of reading and analyzing that I still need to do. But that's sort of all I have for now. Thank you so much for being here. And I do have a lot of people to thank, many of whom have actually turned up here. There's of course my parents, and I should really thank my mother, who is no more, but she is the one who gave me this love for Tamil Nadu and this love for social sciences. And really, without her, I don't think I would have even come down this path, and my dad for coming with me on field work. And I think she is here, but Srinidhi Krishnan for really going through this entire thing with me. She knows my project as much as I do. And of course, all of my other friends who have turned up to support me. Thank you. And this is one of my favorite memes. It's from NumTot, or New Urban Memes for Transit Oriented Teens. So that is just how I like to end today. Thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Nirupama. That was really excellent. I'm so pleased to see how your project is blooming. First of all, hi, everyone. I'm Rona Kapadia, Associate Professor and Director of the Interdepartmental Graduate Concentration in Gender and Women's Studies. And I'm so happy to have partnered with Ramona Gupta and the folks at WLRC this year on this fabulous graduate works in progress series. And Nirupama, you took the spirit of the occasion to heart in the sense that you shared with us a little bit of your project, the way you're thinking about it, past, present, future. I love the way that you're taking the seemingly innocuous site of a bus stop as the point of departure, literally, not to make a dad joke, but the point of departure into thinking about longing and work and pleasure and play and gender and really sort of unraveling all of those elements in a really beautiful way. So at this point, I want to actually introduce your interlocutor. So we are going to go till 15 minutes after the hour. So for the next 15 minutes or so, Nirupama is going to be in conversation both with two of her other mentors here at UIC. And it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Tarani Bedi, who is Associate Professor of Anthropology at UIC, who is an economic, political, and urban anthropologist conducting research in South Asia and more recently in Southeast Asia. Tarani is author of The Dashing Ladies of Shiv Sena, Political Matronage in Urbanizing India from SUNY Press in 2016. And her second book, I was happy to see, Mumbai Taximen, Autobiographies and Automobilities in India, was just published by University of Washington Press's Global South Asia series. So congrats, Tarani. And then we'll also hear from Dr. Sanjeev Vidyarthi, who's Associate Professor of Urban Planning and Policy and the Director of the Master of City Design Program, as well as a Senior Fellow at the Great Cities Institute. Trained as an architect, urban designer, and spatial planner, Sanjeev is the author of a number of books and publications, and he studies how to make better plans for places, exploring spatial plans and city design efforts in a variety of settings like planned neighborhoods, new towns, historic cities, and mega regions. Sanjeev's research explores who does and should do the planning work. And I think Dr. Vidyarthi and Dr. Bedi are the perfect interlocutors for this conversation. So Nirupama, you're making excellent decisions and excellent choices in the folks that you're bringing into communion. And I want to turn things over to Dr. Bedi and Dr. Vidyarthi, whoever wants to start to get us going.
Sanjeev, do you want to go first?
Sure, Tarini. This is, as Ronak rightly said, you know, this is a, I sort of enjoyed the talk very much, Nirupama. Thank you for sort of laying out, you know, the entire thinking and ideas that are sort of you grappling with at this point in time. Not much work has been done on this at some level in my mind, especially from the perspective of how people organize transportation in the regional cities. In some of the largest cities, as folks might know, we have semblance of what's called transportation planning in this country. And there is a sectorial plan making effort within the transportation field, but not in places like Madurai, I suspect. You know, I would be curious to see if you find something called a transportation plan for Madurai, unless it has been done very lately and still perhaps sits on a shelf as a document and doesn't have a life on the field. Interesting work, and you sort of bring in the gender angle to it, which I think is very important, especially from the perspective of everyday commute both around the bazaar and also other activities which are at the heart of a temple town like Madurai. Tarani, I think this would follow very neatly into your footsteps. I'm thinking of your work around the Kali Pili taxi. And Nick Theodore and I were just a few days ago taking a ride in a Kali Pili taxi, and we were thinking of the work you have done. So I think that's the direction for this work, and I would be happy to see it moving in that direction.
Thank you. Thanks, Sanjeev. And thank you, Nirupama. And thank you, everyone, for being here. I apologize. It's almost midnight for me. I have also been riding around in these buses. I'm in India. I've been riding around in these buses and trains, etc., quite a bit over the last several days myself. But there are two things, you know, which I think are so generative from the, you know, and I'll maybe make a few comments. I am not an urban planner, and that's why I really appreciate Sanjeev's feedback and sort of comments on these things. But I'll speak to some of the kinds of themes that I feel are so compelling in the project that you've laid out. And, you know, so a couple of things is that I think in infrastructure, right, the studies of infrastructure, certainly in anthropology, and perhaps even in urban planning, I think there tends to be a certain kind of approach to infrastructure, which is, for lack of a better term, secular, right? Infrastructure is kind of the science of transportation planning, right? But what Nirupama does so beautifully, I think, or is thinking about so generatively, is infrastructure as sort of in its linguistic forms, in its gendered forms, in its religious and caste forms, you know. So it's infrastructure never, and the fact that you're doing this in Madurai, which is a temple city, you know, where, I mean, temple cities, as we know, you know, were fundamentally important in planning of infrastructure of how to get to the temple, right? How pilgrims might get there. And, you know, I will say this, I'm actually at the moment working on the border of India and Pakistan between two shrines. And it's actually quite interesting to see how most, you know, that how religious shrines, even in today's world, actually are so important in thinking about movement, right? And I think that that's something maybe you want to take much, you know, as seriously as possible, is to think in this kind of more, and you do this, I think, in wonderful ways in your presentation here, which is, you know, this kind of layered form of infrastructure, you know, of infrastructure thinking that begins, and actually probably doesn't even begin with the temple city. It perhaps begins with people who, you know, who walked, you know, in order to build the temples, who actually built infrastructure by walking, right? By roads, they dreamt up pathways which could. So I think that, you know, thinking about infrastructure in all these kind of more nuanced ways, which is not necessarily, and I think that's the wonderful part about working in South Asia, is that all of the things you think, you know, Sanjeev, maybe you'll, I don't know if you agree or disagree with me, but all of these kind of universal terms sort of get thrown to the wind in some ways, because we're working in these multilingual contexts. And, you know, what does it mean? What does a bus mean, right? And so what is, so you're kind of, I think what your project is doing, and you tie yourself to sort of spatial analysis, but actually what you're doing is that, you know, while mapping and movement and transportation are all spatial things, there are also ways of, and I think Ronak said this in the very beginning, there are also ways of placemaking, right? And what I found so fascinating is that you are actually not simply speaking of movement, but you're speaking of not just of spatial experience, but infrastructure here is a sonic experience. It's a, you know, it's a kind of, it's an experience of leisure. It's an experience, and I actually think that making of social space where women actually live their lives in these different kinds of sonic spaces. Like, for example, you had that beautiful thing of the cellars. You know, women might hear cellars in very different ways from men when they're in on the move, because they have to attend to shopping before they go home, or buying the flowers for prayers, or buying the flowers to put in front of the puja, or the temple, or the gods, or whatever. So I think that, you know, by kind of making disaggregating what you mean by the social might be useful. So the social is not just one thing, especially when you're commuting. And I think that what's so wonderful, what is happening, I think, in mobility studies more generally across the board, and I think in what you're doing here is what is so terrific, is that you're kind of moving away from the fixity, really what has been the fixity of urban theory, and starting to think with materiality and sound and, you know, what women do, you know, the cell phone. I think that's so wonderful that women are on their cell phones, which is also a sonic experience, right? All the noise of commuting. So I think that thinking disaggregating what you mean by social space might be a helpful kind of analytical way to think about it. And it might even help you methodologically. And maybe I can kind of suggest what I think you're doing quite interestingly in methodological terms. There's a lot of work in infrastructure and transport planning that we use this term mapping. And Sanjeev, I'd like to hear, what do you mean by map? What do planners mean when you say mapping? I'm posing this question to you because I want us to have a kind of a conversation about methodologically, what does it mean? You know, mapping is a spatial thing, obviously, but it's also social. It's very much a social practice. What would you say is mapping? As a planner, when you use the term mapping, what would that be?
Yeah, good question. Mapping to my mind would be, locating and identifying different kinds of activity on a landscape. We can think both in terms of physical features and as well as in terms of social activity that use those physical features, including the infrastructure, to carry out intended activities. Mm-hmm. So, broadly speaking. Sort of builds on the older idea of cartography, where we sort of, geographers set out to fix the coordinates and sort of, put together the base map, if you will, of the entire planet. But I want to pick on the idea of infrastructure a little bit, if you permit me here. Broadly speaking, the way I see Nirupama's project is that she will tell us the story of who all organizes transportation and mobility in a regional Indian city of Madurai, right? Who all organizes it and how? It's multimodal. It sort of brings together the physical infrastructure created by different actors, starting from the National Highway Authority of India down to the municipality, right? Different kinds of roads, different kinds of modes of transportation. Now private actors like Ola, more informally conceived auto rickshaws, walking and biking, right? And then there is the whole social you were talking about, right? So at the broadest scale to my mind, this would be a story of how transportation is, who all are organizing it and how. And the second is, this is all intentional, right? I mean, this is not happening. People are thinking, people are making plans here. This is not state planning. The state plans play a little bit of role in terms of providing, more formally organized infrastructure, but it's a lot of social actors, right? I mean, that vendor is making plan that I will go after 11 a.m. because my ride is free, right? So there is a lot of planning that people are doing and especially women are doing from Nirupama's lens. And then social actors and providers and suppliers and consumers and users. And it's a story to my mind, so right, the broader story of how, who all organizing it and how. And then it's a story of intentional action that people are conceiving and pursuing in the pursuit of mobility, getting from point A to point B as the urban unfolds, right? So there is that historic core of Madurai. Then there is sort of the post-independence Madurai, and now there's sort of post-liberalization Madurai. It's sort of, all these roads have opened up a hinterland. So a radius of 30, 40 kilometers is sort of the regional Madurai, for example, today, right? So it's that urban that unfolds, that's enough for a PhD, I would imagine. If you can handle these challenges and map it, as Tarini is saying, right? I'm just still, how's this landscape organized? What stuff exists where? How does this function together? It seems chaotic, as in that announcement, but nonetheless, it's functioning. And that's a beautiful dissertation right there.
Yeah, I guess, so methodologically, because I think that you make this really good distinction, Sanjeev, between state plans, and this is, obviously these are discussions, state plans, and then who are all of the actual social actors making these. Methodologically, I actually love this occupancy mapping technique that comes from Chief Kerry Moose, who is an Inuit chief, And that's actually a very interesting method, actually, to ask people to actually work with, rather than you doing the mapping, actually have, you know, people, you know, draw how they actually use particular spaces and where, you know, and you talked a lot about questions of safety and things like that. You know, what are the places where people might congregate for safety? What are the places where people might congregate where they are women or, you know, trans folks or, you know, lower caste folks might collect for, you know, sharing food or buying, you know, or sharing certain kind of, you know, spaces of leisure, maybe showing off YouTube videos to each other. You know, I mean, commuting is made up of so many things, right? It's not just getting from point A to point B, as you very beautifully point out. And, you know, also the question of like that commuting always is unidirectional. You know, I love the book by Dion Brand. I don't know if you've read the book, The Map, what is it called? The Map to the Door of No Return. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. And it actually does really generate these questions of, you know, sometimes it's actually not great to get outside and move around. Sometimes you do get lost, both psychically, existentially, you know, Ronak is put, yeah. I think it's a book everybody should read, actually. Anyone who even uses the term mapping would benefit greatly from something like this, not just anthropologists. And I think that, you know, so maybe thinking through these kinds of community, you know, these participatory mapping, because you did talk quite a lot about methodology. I wonder if that could be helpful, because these are women who seem to be finding their way. And you might actually find that people don't always, you know, it's not always positive. In fact, commuting is not always a great thing. Right? Leaving home is not always wonderfully pleasurable, even when you seek it out. So I think, you know, thinking about working with people, having them draw their own maps might be useful, especially in the transit, you know, because you have these like three wonderful bus stops that you're working with, you know, might be very useful to for people to map how they move from one place to another. And layer that with other GIS, because you're so skilled with other kinds of more conventional mapping techniques, that could be helpful. Because, you know, I think that what's so beautiful about projects like this is that, you know, either you do, at one point, planners did the mapping, and then ethnographers did the documenting. But in fact, with participatory mapping, you can do both together. You can map and document at the same time. And I think that that's something that, you know, more kind of, and participatory mapping is a very important kind of feminist methodology, which draws from, you know, from places that, and practices that people have been, you know, have been doing for a very long time, especially in temple cities. You know, I think this is the other thing. So the Madurai plan might actually be, you know, the plan you find, you might in fact find other archives, I wonder, that might suggest other kinds of movement which had nothing to do with the plan, right? And it may not be mapped archives, it may be other, you know, other places to look, and maybe we can think a little bit more about that. So, but yeah, I think that those are some of the very generative things that your project, I think, does really remarkably well. And perhaps as you move forward, I can really see, you know, methodologically being a mapper, but also a documenter, being, you know, kind of taking on infrastructure in all of its non-secular forms. And I mean non-secular in kind of a radical way, a radical way of being non-secular, not in the way in which, you know, we are kind of living in the Indian context today. Oh gosh, you're recording this. And I have to leave for Pakistan day after tomorrow. Okay.
That was rather tame, and nothing will be posted for a couple of weeks. But Dharni, you've offered such a treasure trove of feedback, and I see Nirupama scribbling away here. So I wanted to name, yes, we are recording this. And so, and Nirupama, you will be able to download the feedback and sort of take a second to marry. But let's take a breath. I mean, I'm noticing the time. We have 15 minutes, and I want to invite folks in the chat to please, you know, offer questions or comments or supportive affirmations. And Nirupama, let's take a moment for you to sort of download and also, you know, respond back to things that you're hearing from Dr. Bedi and Dr. Vidyarthi. What are things that are coming top of mind to you that you want to name?
I think Dr. Bedi's, the idea of the sonic infrastructure is actually really striking. And in fact, it brings me, this is where the conversation is going to become very specific, but this is something that we did in your class, Prof. K, with the Elliott Powell reading and thinking about sonic, the sonic as a way, you know, as an integral part of life. It's something that we don't really consider. And so, and I hadn't thought about it. So thank you so much for bringing that lens that I think it's really interesting to look at it. And Dr. Vidyarthi's idea of essentially the way, at least the way I understood it, and feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, is that it is, and as a, it is a narrative, it is a story of Madurai that I do wish to tell. And through what aspects, I'm still deciding, and this is, I've just laid out all of these different things that came up to me in the field, but both of these perspectives from the idea or the story of planning, the story of transport, and this sort of excavating what infrastructure and, you know, especially with social or sonic infrastructures, both of these are immensely exciting for me. And I'd really like to, I guess, go back and sort of let it all sink in, because I'm still processing all of it. Like Prof. K said, I've just scribbled away. So just to think through all of that will take me time. But thank you so much.
Can I just speak back to one thing, you know, with a really robust set of remarks and forms of feedback. And so thank you both of you for really generative ideas here for Nirupama. One thing that really stood out to me in addition to the sonic element. So it's almost like, how do you take a phenomenological perspective to your case site and say, attending to the visual, the visual economies, the sonic economies, the way that those other sensuous modes of knowing not only impinge on the site, but then can become lines of flight for how you move through your case site, right? Which is, I think, also speaks to what Tharani was saying about the participatory mapping as being a feminist methodology, and that there are all of these other alternative approaches, right, that you can avail yourself of. And of course, that's why as a GWS grad concentrator, we want you to think in the most interdisciplinary ways as possible and be informed by the kind of feminist and queer studies perspectives that have transformed both how to think about the case, how to think about your archives, little a archives in the broadest of sense, and then the tools, you know, the toolkit that you use, you know, to bear on the questions you're asking. So I see there are a couple of hands raised here. And so I'm wondering, Ramona, what's the best thing here? Is it okay? Oh, so I see the note that says that if you do have a question, you can indeed raise your hand. And so maybe I can't see folks on my, let me go to gallery view. Let's see, there that you are. Hi, Kate, I'm gonna come to you first, and then Shravanthi, I'll come to you next.
First of all, great presentation and conversation. I'm really excited to hear about these multiple methods of approaching mobility. And I love the observation about how women are actors in making public spaces of public transport. I think those are some really promising findings that will speak to the social construction of space. One question I had is, I'm sorry, I forget the term, but are you considering the shared fixed route cars as public transport? And I think that might be a promising space to look at this whole landscape of actors that make mobility. So that's one question. And then we don't need to take a lot of time here, but coming from a domestic perspective, you know, I'm just really curious how much public transport is used and how common it is.
Yeah, so for the first, thanks so much for being here and your comments, Dr. Loeb. So for the first question regarding the cars or shared fixture, I'm not sure if you were referring to these shared autos. That is, it's really something that's come up so often that I believe it's going to shape to be integral, and I should be keeping an eye out for it, perhaps maybe even talking to shared auto drivers and commuters of the shared auto as well, and map out different routes and see if they work with bus routes. These are just ideas that came up as you were asking, honestly. So yeah, I think it will prove to play an integral part in the future. And regarding the usage, I think Dr. Bedi and Dr. Vidyarthi are much more suited to answer that question. But yeah, public transport is widely used in India, and in Madurai, it is, because the idea of public itself, what public means in public transport itself, is being redefined with the whole idea of shared economy, and not just through the mobile platforms like Uber or Ola, but also through shared autos and all of these, or short buses that the corporations have in certain cities. So it is heavily used to answer, but even as we continue to redefine what public really means, I guess that would be how I put it.
I think, Nirupama, just a quick thing. I think Kate asked an important question, because I think even the use of the term public in most parts of South Asia, this is not the Habermasian public. It's not the public, the sort of social welfare state public. Public is actually the term used for the people, right? And I think that, you know, a lot of these forms of transport actually do define themselves as for the people, even if they're in the private sector, even if they're owned in some ways by private organizations. Most people who take these things that are taken by the people are called public, the public, right? This is for the public. So I think that that's actually very important. It's a very important linguistic term of what public constitutes in the South Asian context. And I think that, Kate, you raise an important question. I think it's something for you to pay attention.
It also helps us provincialize, you know, the kind of Western imagination around transit and transportation writ large. And so I very much appreciate that. Shravanti, let's come to you next. Or Sanjeev, did you have something to say?
No? Yeah, I just wanted to add a couple more things to what Tarini just said. So I sort of think of public as a synonym for common people in the South Asian context. So that would be one, you know, common people, ordinary people. And the second is, if I'm not wrong, I think walking is still the predominant mode of transportation in regional cities, right? So you don't want to lose sight of that while you're sort of looking, or you can distinguish and say motorized transportation, right? And motorized mobility, and then you move away from the most dominant form of urban commute, which is still walking. Yeah, that's all, Rana. Go ahead.
Excellent, thank you. Shravanti, nice to see you.
Hi, nice to see you too. I have one affirmation, two comments, one question, and I'll be really quick. So first of all, I thought it was really nicely done, and I'm so excited to see the shape your project is taking, you know, from the various discussions we've had, to actually see this in, you know, this form is really, really nice to see. Two comments. One is that I thought there were like some great intersections about gender and commuting in three particular ways. One is women and how they access public transport. The second is women as auto drivers, bus conductors, and that, you know, how that intersects. And third is you as a researcher and a woman and a user of public transport. So I feel like those three coming together would be really exciting to see how you bring that up. The second is about, and I'm asking, the second is about the sonic analysis. And I thought it's really interesting because Tamil Nadu is so big on film music. And I know that's something which is prevalent in public transport, in public spaces and all that. It's not something you can ignore. So I think that'll be really interesting to see if that's something you want to do, about how that plays out in your work. My question is about how you see caste playing out in the space of this public transport thing. Especially, it's really interesting because the main bus stand is called Periyar bus stand, which is like, you know, an iconic anti-caste figure. So I wonder how the politics of that plays out. Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much, Ravanti. And yeah, thank you for your very sweet affirmation and your comments. This whole, and I'm really interested, as you pointed out, in the reflexive part of it as well, like the reflexive methodology of how I place myself as a researcher, especially because I'm from Chennai, though I'm currently situated here, and all of these different little things. And with respect to the cost and public transport, that is something that I'm really grappling with and trying to see how it comes out. I guess the easiest coding that usually happens, and this is something that I know from Chennai, but I don't know how it works in Madurai yet, because caste is so deeply embedded that I need to embed myself more in the city to understand how it works in that in this city's fabric. But in Chennai, it would be through language and how different people or different communities would speak in Tamil, or the kind of languages, the phrases that they, the words that they would use. In Madurai, something that I have noticed so far is about the spaces that seem to come, and this is because it's a temple city, but how close to temple are certain residential communities, or that is something that was alluded to me by some of my interlocutors, especially those who were domestic help or coming from I don't think they called it slum in Madurai. They called it something else, which has slipped my mind entirely right now. But just in the through housing, I guess, through zones of housing is how I have currently learned to think about caste in Madurai as an urban space. In public transport, as yet, I don't have the answer. And I'd really love to talk with you more and look at just talk to my interlocutors and look at literature, I guess, to understand how it gets coded, especially in smaller cities like Madurai.
Wonderful. I'm conscious of time. I know there's a big comment that just got dropped in the chat, and we have, I think, just about a minute before I have to hand things back to Ramona. So I'm going to let Nirupama try to take that question in, if you can see it in the chat. And as you're reading, let me just say, you know, one of the wonderful things about this, these kinds of spaces is that our speakers, Nirupama today, are able to activate their multiple kin relations. So their mentors, their cohort, grad cohort members, the folks in anthropology, urban planning and policy, GWS. It's so wonderful to see so many people convened here together in April. So thank you all for being here. And Nirupama, I don't know if this is something that you want to quickly respond to, or if it is something you can quickly respond to before we pass things back off to Ramona to close.
Sorry, I muted myself, but I don't think Adarai has a question. Thank you so much, Adarai, for turning up, and yes, fellow Tamilachi. But it's true, this idea of how transport is sort of ignored. We just go about it. It's about convenience, where we want to go. And it's just about that. So to sit down with it and to talk to people, and those are things that I've been writing about as well. This idea of asking, it's significant to me because it's my research, but it's not significant to my interlocutors about where they're going or how they're going. And so to really talk about that is, I guess, what got me interested in the first place. So thank you for that comment, Adarai.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you, Nirupama. And Ramona, take it away.
All right. Just want to make sure I can see everybody here. So thank you all again so much for joining us today. Thank you to our partners in bringing this series together. So Dr. Rona Kaparia and the Gender and Women's Studies Program. We have many great events and programs still coming up this month, including some special events for Sexual Assault Awareness Month in April. We invite you to join us for any and all of them, and you can find information about our events on our website. I'm going to drop the link in the chat here for you. Thank you again to Nirupama, and congratulations as well. Thank you to Dr. Vedi, Dr. Vidyarthi, all of you so much for joining us today. We hope to see you all again soon. We hope you have a wonderful afternoon. Dr. Bailey, we hope you get some sleep given how late it is right now in India. And thank you especially too so much for joining us. It's such an odd hour for you. We appreciate it. Thanks, everybody. Take care.